Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Yes, No, Maybe? Written by Liz Pichon and read by Rupert Grint. Usually, I'm very good at making up my mind, especially when it comes to food. But this morning, it's been a bit tricky. Mostly because Granny Mavis popped round yesterday with a few bits and pieces, including a mini selection pack of breakfast cereals, which are my favourites. Thanks, Granny. She brought other stuff as well that didn't look quite so nice, like two packets of seaweed and wood-flavoured crisps, and a jar of something odd that came in syrup.
I keep forgetting that crisps just get stuck in your granddad's teeth, Granny told me, like I wanted to know. So I thought you might like them, Tom, she said, passing them to me.
I tried really hard not to pull a ew, disgusting kind of face. Instead, I told Granny that she should really give them to Delia. She loves that flavour. Granny said that I was a very thoughtful brother, and I agreed. Which was a result, because now it's all official. The cereal is mine. Delia gets the crisps, and Mum and Dad can have the syrupy stuff. I hid the cereal right at the back of the cupboard to make sure no one else helped themselves before me. So this morning, I'm downstairs nice and early, looking at all the different cereal packets. But I can't make up my mind which one I want to have first. I take off the cellophane wrapper and build a tower of cereal while I have a think. Finally, I decide on the Cocoa Loops. I'm just about to take them when suddenly Delia appears out of nowhere and snatches my cereal. Huh?
Don't mind if I do.
That's mine! Give it back! I shout.
Who says?
Delia wants to know while she opens the cereal. Granny brought them for me. She said I could have them.
You have 5 packets left, Tom. I'm eating this one.
No, you can't, I say, panicking.
Yes, I can. Watch me.
Delia starts pouring milk on the cereal. Then she holds up the bowl really high so I can't reach it.
This is my breakfast and there's nothing you can do about it.
Only, she's wrong. There is something I can do. I charge around the whole kitchen and grab every single spoon I can find from everywhere. Wooden spoons, teaspoons, big spoons, the lot. I shove them all in a plastic bag and hold on to them tightly. Delia is watching me.
Is this really happening? She sighs.
There's one last spoon right next to the sink, and we've both seen it. Delia makes a dash, but I get there first with an expert floor slide and swipe motion. Oh yes, the spoon is mine, I say as I shove it in the bag.
Give me that spoon, Tom.
Delia is getting cross. Give me my cereal, I say. It's a fair swap. Then, just to be on the safe side, I do another whiz round the kitchen and take all the forks as well.
Okay, that's enough,
Delia tells me, trying to sound like Mum. I think she's ready to bargain, so I make a suggestion. I'll give you this box of plain cornflakes if you give me back my Cocoa Loops. They're my favourites.
They're my favourites too. Now hand over a spoon.
But Granny gave you those crisps. I don't tell her what flavour they are.
I don't want crisps for breakfast. I want this cereal, Delia says.
I'm getting desperate. So I say, just give it back, please. Delia starts walking towards me. I'm not exactly sure what she's going to do. I hold the plastic bag in front of me. Then kind of swing it around a bit to stop her from getting any closer. Delia can be sneaky when she wants something.
Back away from the spoons and forks,
I tell her, in case she gets any ideas. Delia stops, looks down, then very slowly opens a drawer and takes out some chopsticks.
You forgot about these,
she laughs. I watch as Delia expertly picks up the Cocoa Loops one by one with the chopsticks. I didn't think of that. There's a loud clattering sound as I drop the bag with all the spoons and forks. Crash! Which instantly alerts Mum and Dad to something not very good going on downstairs. You'll be in trouble now, I tell Delia as she carries on eating my cereal with the chopsticks. She doesn't look that bothered at all. Watching the way Delia is scoffing my cereal, I'm not sure I want it back now. What was that noise? And why is the bag on the floor? Then Dad looks at Delia. Why are you eating with chopsticks? Ask Tom, she says, not looking up. So I explain how Granny Mavis gave me the mini packets of cereal and Delia went and helped herself. Sorry, stole my favourite packet and is eating them right now. I took the spoons to try and stop her. Oh, and the forks too. Mum says I have to, one, put all the cutlery back, two, choose another cereal to eat or be late for school. Then she tells Delia that from now on she should, one, stop pinching my cereal, better late than never, I suppose, two, in future be a lot more mature, which makes her sound like an old piece of cheese. Ha ha. If it will stop you two arguing, I'll buy another pack of mini cereal, Mum tells us in a slightly irritated voice. I nod and Delia mumbles something in between mouthfuls. But then Mum goes and adds, sometime soon. Which is a worry, because whenever she says sometime soon, it usually means not very soon at all, or probably never. Mum tells me again, I promise I'll buy more, Tom. I'm not convinced. If only I hadn't taken so long to make up my mind, none of this would have happened. I take my second favourite choice, Choco Crispies, and put them in a bowl before they get taken too. Eat up or you'll be late for school, Mum tells me. I point out I've only got 4 packets left now. Make that 3 packets, Tom. We've run out of my muesli, Mum says, while helping herself to the cornflakes, which I'm not bothered about. But these are mine. I slip the last packets into my school bag for safekeeping, and I'm about to leave when Mum shouts, Tom, aren't you forgetting something? Uh-oh. Go and brush your teeth, will you? Phew. I hope she hasn't spotted the cereal in my bag. I brush my teeth, and when I come back, Mum doesn't mention anything. She's busy chatting to Dad and discussing what we're doing this weekend. Nothing. Why? What's happening? Dad says, looking confused. We're not doing anything. Nope. Okay. We have nothing planned for this weekend or next weekend either, Mum asks again. I get ready to leave when she adds, have a great day, Tom, but not in a jolly way. I'll try. As I walk out the door, Delia ruffles my hair with her hand. Thanks for breakfast, little brother. Remember, it's good to share, she says. But I'm not sure she means it. On the way to school. What's up with your hair? Derek asked me. That was Delia. She's been annoying me all morning. I tell Derek how she nicks my cereal. I brought the rest of them with me in case she takes those as well. Might just hide everything in my room from now on. You're lucky. Anything I hide, Rooster finds then eats, Derek says. Which is true, I've seen him. My room's a bit messy at the moment, so hiding things is easy. The tricky bit's finding them again. Derek and I are doing fast walking to school to make sure we're not late, when he says, I've got something to tell you about June's dad. June is the slightly annoying girl who lives next door to me and goes to our school, and her dad used to be in a band called Plastic Cup. I ask, what about June's dad? But Derek starts coughing and can't get it out. June's dad, I say again, when Derek stops coughing. You know how my dad won't stop going on about June's dad being in Plastic Cup? Slightly. He's a big fan, I say. Derek agrees and then does an impression of his dad. He keeps on saying, they should get back together and make a new record. I remind Derek, that Plastic Cup album we listened to the other day was great. It's true, I was surprised. Well, you'll never guess what my dad did. I'm curious now. What?
He went over to June's house wearing a plastic cup t-shirt and told him he had to make a new record.
Shame. And I found out something else.
What?
My dad says that plastic cup album we were listening to is worth loads of money.
Really?
But only if it's not scratched or broken.
Oh, I say, for good reason. Because I've just remembered what we did at our last band practice. Dog Zombies band practice.
Catch! Look, I'm Mr. Fullerman.
Whoops.
In class, I sit down at my desk next to Marcus Meldrew, who immediately leans away from me. The first thing he says is, "You haven't got the bug, have you, Tom?"
"What bug?"
"There's a lot of kids coughing and off sick, and I don't want to catch anything because it's an important week for me."
"Why's that?" Marcus starts rolling his eyes like I've asked a really stupid question.
"Don't you remember anything, Tom?"
Then Amy Porter sits down on the other side of me, and she says,
"It's the school's business day coming up, and we're supposed to be thinking up ideas."
"I knew that."
I didn't.
"I've got a brilliant idea, and whatever group I'm in will raise the most money for sure."
Marcus sounds very positive and keen, which makes me wonder what his brilliant idea is. So I ask him,
"Nice try, Tom. I'm not telling you anything. You might pinch my idea."
"I have my own ideas, Marcus. I don't need yours," I say.
"We'll see," Marcus says.
Every year the kids in our school raise money for charity by selling things they've made. Some stuff is more popular than others. Pen holders, marshmallow and fruit kebabs.
Yeah.
Badges.
We're not allowed to sell sweets or fizzy drinks, but homemade cakes are always popular, especially with me.
Mr. Fullerman is sitting at his desk now and says,
"Settle down, Class 5F.
Then he starts coughing. The first thing I notice is that Mr. Fullerman is not looking like his normal self. He looks a bit grey.
"Good morning, everyone."
"Good morning, Mr. Fullerman," we say back. Mr. Fullerman isn't the only one coughing. I turn around to see who it is. Quite a few kids are missing. But Norman's there, so I wave. He makes me laugh by wearing his glasses in a funny way.
Mr. Fullerman starts calling the register, and in between names he says,
"As you can see, not everyone's here because of this bug that people are catching. I might have to reorganise your groups for business day."
"Huh? I'm in a group? What group? Who am I with? How did I not know about this?"
"I hope everyone has some good ideas for raising money this year."
"I know I have," Marcus mutters.
"You'll have a few more days to get your ideas together. Let's see if we can..."
Mr. Fullerman clasps his hand over his mouth to stop coughing. He's saved when the bell goes off for assembly. There's more coughing going on in the hall too. Mr. Keane, our headmaster, is standing in front of everyone and says,
"There seems to be a bit of a bug going round school. We don't want it to spread, so if anyone doesn't feel well or has a really bad cough, please tell your parents or carers to keep you off school."
As soon as Mr. Keane says the words,
"keep you off school,"
everyone starts coughing. Or that's what it sounds like.
all right, that's quite enough of that. Let's have some quiet, please. I'm waiting. Still waiting.
Eventually, the coughing dies down and Mr. Keane begins talking again. Even though I feel absolutely fine and don't have a bug or a cough, being surrounded by kids who are coughing makes me want to cough. My throat's gone a bit dry and tickly. As soon as Mr. Keane starts talking again, the tickle gets a lot worse. I'm trying to stop myself from coughing. Mr. Fullerman is staring at me because I'm fidgeting a lot now. Then Marcus nudges me and says,
"Shh."
Somehow, I keep it under control while Mr. Keane...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.